along that all three components were present, and as well as acidation was present. And again, in vitro, this worked very well. The acidation luciferase when doxycycline was added and all the components were present. So again, several thousand fold induction is accomplished by addition of drugs. And these drugs can be added to animals, which has been used fairly widely to activate transcription. So we wanted then to see if this would work in vivo, and we do work on the retina, and this is our go-to system for testing anything. We're able to electroporate plasmids in very trivially into a postnatal day zero mouse. And here we're adding five plasmids at once. The retina takes up quite a few plasmids and allows us to do these kind of experiments quite easily. So we had one plasmid encoding GFP to activate the system. We had this cheese tomato readout to see if the system was working. We had plasmids encoding the fusion proteins, and we had an electroporation control plasmid. We introduced this into the retina in vivo, and then we let it go anywhere from a few days to a few months, and then we looked at sessions to see if the GFP positive cells had turned on tomato. So we can ask several questions. One is just, is the system working, since it is dependent on GFP? We then worked at Boton Rossett's lab to see if we could do physiology with the system. We asked whether the gene that we turn on is not tomato, a Cree, and if so, would the Cree accomplish recombination? And then we wanted to look further at physiology. So by doing these introductions of electroporation and then looking at sessions, we could see the system was very tight. So these are now sessions, and this is the series of sessions from an animal that receives GFP, and this is the control with no GFP present. So you can see when GFP was present, CD tomato or readout indeed did turn on. So it's a very pretty efficient turn on, as a matter of fact, with no GFP, almost no CD tomato. It's not very honest when we had to show this session because there is one death cell. So when we do quantify, it's well below 1%. So without the GFP, these components don't come together spontaneously to create transcription. So we then wanted to know if neuronal physiology was impacted in some negative light by jumping in all these plasmids. In fact, we collaborated with Bernardo Sabatini's lab. Genia Sosolowski then was performing physiology on the system. And what Genia would do is the electroporate plasmids in utero and so lateral ventricle and drive the plasmids into progenitor cells. The cells that ended up with those plasmids were often pyramidal cells in the cortex. So she could wait a few weeks and make sessions with slides or slices and then do physiology on them. So this is a series of images from those sessions. So you can see that there's a lot of cells that don't have GFP. Look over here in the GFP channel. You can see these two cells are expressing GFP. Here's an example of a cell that's not. And this cell is also expressing cheese tomato, implying it's gotten all of the components and the system is working. So the question is, would this cheese tomato cell exhibit any kind of aberrant physiology relative to a GFP only or a non-transfected cell? So Genia looked at that in a variety of ways. These are the trains of action potentials from ingestion of current. So non-electroporated cell, GFP only, or cheese tomato cell, you can see they look quite similar. If you quantitated that, you can see that down here, there's no perturbation of the action potential frequency from the introduction of all of these components. There's no change in the membrane resistance or capacitance. So this then said that it's possible to add all of these components and still carry out physiology. Now we wanted to know if you could use this to do physiology experiments. And for this, we collaborated with Boton Rossett's lab at the FMI in Basel. They recorded from retinal cells. So we went back to discuss recent GFP animal that I introduced in the beginning, which has GFP only in a subset of bipolar cells. The connectivity of those bipolar cells is not known. Here's just some images of those cells. So we electroporated in initially just to see if this could drive a gene under control of the system. We introduced this CD tomato, and you can see we only got tomato positive cells among the GFP positive cells, so this was working specifically. And then we electroporated a construct which had channel rhodopsin, not the genetic protein, to use the cherry. Now many of you know that one can then use light of the right wavelength to depolarize the cell that includes the channel rhodopsin. So we electroporated this plasmid in and used GFP, the endogenous GFP then, to activate the cells. So I was just advancing what shouldn't have. But Boton's lab then records from ganglion cells, the output cells of the retina, which are connected to the bipolar cells. And when they shine light, on the right wavelength shown here, and they block input from photoreceptors, they could then see channel opening very well in the presence of this channel rhodopsin construct. Only in the GFP cells make it all the proper controls to see if this wasn't under the regulation of the system. They could then inject dyes, the cell that they recorded from, to see something about the morphology of the ganglion cell that's being activated by these bipolar cells. Bipolar cells are here in red. So once they started to put together some concept of what kind of circuitry these bipolar cells in the ganglion cell are participating in. We wanted to know if there were also sent to other species other than mice. It's quite a collection of GFP strains in the zebrafish, and as shown here, we'll be collaborating with Matt Harris's lab, Catherine Henke in his lab, and we looked at a GFP transgenic of zebrafish, introduced the components, and you can see we could get CD tomato readout. Again, it was very specific to animals, no GFP, had no CD tomato, and this is an animal we were just monitoring for structure and morphology to see, again, if development proceeded normally in the presence of these components, and as far as we can tell, it did. So to summarize the T-dog portion, so T-dog for transcription dependent upon GFP, the system can drive gene expression, and we can use different transcription activation domains, dialing it up or dialing it down, depending on the activation domain. We can use a variety of binding sites, I showed you TET and GAL4, but you can extend it to others. It can be regulated by drugs, I showed you that with the TET system and doxycycline. It can lead to pre-mediated excision, I didn't show you that, but instead of tomato or channel rhodopsin, the alpha gene can decrease, in which case it can then size, cross alleles, or pre-dependent alleles. I showed you some of the results from Boton's lab, one can use an optogenetic system. And it works across species. So this is well and good, and these plasmids are all available to anybody who wants them from Pagene. I encourage some of you to think of applications. Again, you can drive any gene, for example, CRISPR could be activated only in GFP positive cells. But we want to see that this system could extend to non-modular proteins. So I told you these transcription domains are very useful as fusion partners because they have these autonomous folding domains to carry out specific functions. But many proteins do not, or they're not known to have such domains. So we wanted to know if we could use a known modular domain protein and drive it, again, as fusions that would be GFP dependent. So the system I just told you about had three components. It had a transcription activation domain, a DNA binding domain, and then one has to introduce a plasmid that will be recognized and driven by the system. So three components. If one can instead fuse the protein of interest, here the example is Cree, but one took Cree instead of driving it transcriptionally, so the protein itself and fuse it to these GDPs, one can reduce the complexity to two components and have the protein activity directly regulated from scaffolding on GFP. So this was very hard to get to work, but Jonathan managed to do it. It was not obvious where to fuse these things, how to make these linker structures, where exactly to split the Cree, but he managed to get it to work. There were 100 constructs that went into this. And again, he used the simplest as we got in vitro, was able to get a system that had a very great GFP dependent. So this is Cree combination in the presence of GFP or in the absence, and this is about some of the components. So in vitro, it works quite well. We then wanted to test it in vivo, and as I've shown you, we can use electroporation, but we know that many neuroscientists are interested in using this kind of system with an AAV delivery. AAV vectors are very convenient to inject into all kinds of locations in the entire body. They happen to work quite well in the nervous system. So we could use electroporation, and we tested what we call free dogs for free-dependent on GFP, and it did work well. We decided to go for a viral delivery system. We've also created some transgenics, which we are currently testing. So if you have a system where you want to turn on the components in all GFP cells, not just those that are infected with the virus, hopefully you can use a transgenic cross, and for fish, they can use microinjection. So we created AAVs that encode the two fusion proteins, the two components that you have of the Cree. We had them at the readout of this experiment, tomato, and then we included a GFP or a non-GFP related green fluorescent protein called ZS green. And the question was, when we include GFP but not ZS green, but we see tomato, that would actually then mean that all four of these components have to be infected into the same. cell, and the efficiency of that just depends on the type of the virus and the infection site that you're using. So here's a Daltonic focal section taken from a retina when GFP was included or ZS green was included. This is the level of the horizontal cell, this is the cell type in the middle of the retina. You see a very good infection and lots of GFP. And we also have lots of the tomato indicating that the Cre dog was actually doing this job. If we use a non-related protein, a non-GFP derivative, which is a different protein called ZS green, we got no tomato. So again, the system was very tight, well under 1% in terms of background. But we introduced GFP here as a virus, but we want to be able to see if this system will work with endogenous or transgenically expressed GFP. And so that we collaborate with Andy Huberman lab, Ankur Dundee, his postdoc. Andy's lab has characterized lines of mice where GFP is expressed in subsets of ganglion cells, these output neurons. And one of them in particular, you can see here, this is a view from inside the retina looking at a subset of ganglion cells that light up the GFP in this transgenic. We then gave one cocktail of viruses again that has two components for Cre dog and CD tomato as a readout, and they infected in vivo with this cocktail. And the question was, would CD tomato turn on only in the GFP positive cells? And that was true, that's shown here, and you can see that only GFP cells turned it on. Now again, this wasn't super efficient, and that has to do with the viral titer and delivery method. They studied these a lot, they know where they project in terms of targets in the brain, as well as the viral genetic nucleus is the target, so they also looked to see if these cells with the CD tomato were still targeting, normally in abnormal morphology, and at least for first approximation they do. So again, hopefully these things are benign or neutral in terms of neuron development and physiology. But to look more closely at physiology, we again wanted to have recordings from slices, and so this is collaborating with Weber Gehr's lab. Stephanie Rudolph, his postdoc, had a transgenic one that expressed GFP in Purkinje cells of the cerebellum and molecular layer into neurons. And so she introduced the Cre dog components, and this time the readout was again shared with us, and it wasn't just CD tomato. Here's the injection site, and again, she looked at specificity and quantified, and that was again well under 1%, that is, cells were not GFP positive, don't express this channel without infusion. She then produced slices into recordings, the same kinds of things that Genia did, and looking at Purkinje cells with molecular layer into neurons. And if you look down here again, you can see membrane properties, actual potentials, are unperturbed by the introduction of all these components. So again, hopefully meaning that one can use the system and dry channel often or any optogenic protein without worry about perturbing the physiology of the cells through the method itself. So for Cre-dog, then, the summary is that we can do gain and loss of function, that is, GFP-positive cells basically become Cre-positive cells, and A1 cells can then recombine whatever predependent alleles are present, either by viral delivery or endogenous predependent allele. I'm not going to go through this, but there is a way to use viruses, other viruses, to do transgenic tracing, and you might know that when one uses those systems, it's very useful to have the viruses for the tracing infect particular cells. Normally, that's arranged by a pre-allele in a transgenic. One can now envision using the whole repertoire of GFP-positive transgenics and directing your synaptic tracing to just the GFP-positive cells rather than having to have a Cre or flip one. I'll show you some examples of optogenetics of Cre-dog, and I'll spend a minute talking about this. Many of you probably know, again, that GFP is often expressed in more than one cell type. Cre often has a transgene, similarly has that problem, flip another recombination. Similarly, you don't get a single cell type from any of these transgenics. Susan Demetri's lab has worked out something called intersectional methods to then take a mouse that has flip under one set of regulatory elements, Cre under another, and make those three animals such that where a cell expresses both Cre and flip, one can get a more refined subset of cells that one can then manipulate genetically. So if one does that cross and then introduces a gene that's Cre plus flip dependent, one will get activation of that gene only in a subset of the Cre or the flip cells, and that gives you much more specificity for the perturbation of manipulation. So one can now do that with GFP plus a recombination one. So one can take any of the GFP transgenics and cross to a Cre or flip one. Okay, so everything I told you about so far was about GFP antibodies. Using GFP in transgenics to get the cell type specificity, and then using the antibodies to activate genes. But we wanted to know if we could go beyond GFP antibodies and use other cell type specific proteins, endogenous proteins, non-transgenic proteins, which would give us much more facility, much more access to other cell types that weren't in a transgenic mouse fashion, and also might go beyond model organisms. So the next part, the last part I'd like to tell you about, is Jonathan and Eugene Gogleski's idea to expand this to non-GFP antibodies. So they had the idea to create a conditional system where the condition was the presence or absence of an epitope. So here's the idea. Take an antibody, mutagenize it so it was unstable in the absence of a cognate epitope. Make fusions of that destabilized antibody, so various moieties, Cre, flip, Cas9, whatever you like. And the idea was in the absence of the binding partner, the epitope, it would get degraded, so the inactive, no activity of the fusion protein. But in the presence of the epitope, and we started with GFP, it would be stabilized and therefore active. So once it had Cre or flip or Cas9, etc., active only in a cell of the epitope. So this is not a simple system because it's a single protein that one needs to deliver with whatever the delivery mechanism is. And it's also a generalizable strategy that one can envision binding partners being stabilized through their interaction and being unstable in the absence of it doesn't even have to be antibodies. So to see if this would work, the first thing we did is we took an antibody, one of our favorite ones, is one of the GFP antibodies, and we mutagenized it throughout the protein using TCR mutagenesis. We took that library and we fused it to a blue fluorescent protein. So this is not a GFP derivative, this is called TAG-GFP. It was a readout that we chose. So we have now a library of mutagenized antibodies fused to GFP. These were then encapsulated into a retroviral library. We then took that library and we infected cells in culture. And the library not only had the mutagenized fusion protein, but it also included an HPV readout from defined infected cells, regardless of the status of the fusion protein. So we infected cells, and then we faxed out and isolated red cells. So now we know these are the infected cells. And we looked for the ones that were red, but not blue. Okay, so that was the key. No blue fluorescent protein, that is, no fusion protein expression. Now that could be for a variety of problems. But we wanted cells that did not have the blue fluorescent protein. The next step was to take those cells, grow them for a bit, and then infect them again, but this time with an AAV encoding GFP. And the hope was that when GFP was present, we would now see blue, because some of these, again, were unstable in the absence of GFP, but could respond to GFP by becoming stable and therefore blue, and indeed we could find those. So this worked reasonably well. We then isolated these individual mutants, sequenced them, and then tested them individually. We made combinations of the mutations, looked for those that were the most destabilizing, and we also tested them in other ways, which I'll tell you about now. The first step, again, our go-to experiment is to see if this works in vivo. We use the retina, and in this case, now we're transfecting in, electroporating in, a single destabilized nanobody that's, again, active against the GFP, and then we encode either GFP or an irrelevant protein to see if we get blue only when GFP is present and without the other protein present. So again, if you look here, that worked very nicely. So here's the case where we included GFP, lots of GFP-positive cells, and the pseudopositive is actually blue fluorescence that was turned on only in the GFP-positive cells. Very low background. If we didn't include GFP, we only included BSN as a control protein, no blue fluorescence. So this was very tight in vivo. We then were curious as to whether it was working with the method that we were hoping, or the method that we were hoping, which was a degradation scenario. So we tested this in vitro using a Western blot. So we put in our destabilized fusion protein with an epitope that was easy to score on a Western blot. All of these cells had the same amount of backplasmids. YFP is a GFP derivative. It should stabilize. So if you look over here, when YFP was present, we had a whopping amount of the fusion protein. So here, if YFP was absent, we put in the same amount of the fusion protein. We had no fusion protein. So there's a huge difference in the amount of protein present when epitope is present, consistent with the idea of degradation. We can also titrate in the epitope shown here. So the epitope, but here's this, the fusion protein now stabilized. And this is actually a fairly linear response, which is nice in terms of controlling what's going on just by changing the dosing of the epitope. I'm going to skip over this for time, but it's nice to have a linear readout. If you have a ternary or binary system, you can actually touch without the interaction. So those of you who are aficionados of this started working through the different cardio films for some degradation, which was like, yes. And to test that, we did the experiment again in vitro. We included blockers of degradation through the UPS system. So look over here, this is a destabilized fusion protein. When it is delivered without its epitope and with an active UPS system, we get no fusion protein. If, on the other hand, we include either of these two blockers of UPS, we now get the protein back. So this is all consistent with the mechanism we envisioned, that in the absence of epitope, the protein is being degraded through the UPS system. Okay, now looking at the sequences, these mutations that then gave us the conditional stability, we were happy to see that these mutations were in the framework of the heavily conserved regions of these amyloid nanobodies. So these are three different species of nanobodies, and what we're showing here is the framework regions, which are the heavily conserved regions among all nanobodies, and this is where these mutations map. So these are the most important of the mutations we found. So this is great, because what it told us is we might be able to substitute these mutations in other nanobodies without having to do a laborious screening procedure. We could just take any nanobody the sequence was published, swap in these mutations, and see if we now have conditional stability, and test that by adding the epitope. So that worked quite well. The majority of nanobodies we tested were conditionally stabilized by these mutations. And I'll show you some of the applications then that we put this to. So if I could show you this set of panels, this is now to make a flip recombination dependent on GFE. We use a stabilized GFE antibody. And look at the activity over here. This is again a readout for the cyclase after flip activity. We took flip and we fused it either a single destabilized antibody or a double. And we asked, is the GFE dependent for recombination? And as you see over here, we have a lot more recombination when GFE was present versus when it was absent. So this is about a 600-fold induction of flip activity by having this dual antibody domain and again having these destabilized domains. If we don't use the destabilized domain, here's the normal antibody that doesn't have GFE dependent for activity. Now this is great because first of all, here's this reagent, flip dog, which again you can all use this in the same way you use pre dog. You only have to deliver one protein. It's active. It can use, be used again in a combination with, let's say, a Cre strain. If you have a Cre plus a flip mouse cross and you introduce this, you'll have again a Cre plus flip intersection through genetic methylation. The second thing to show us though is we could put two antibody domains on a single protein, and that gave us the possibility of doing an AND function, again to create more specificity in the flip readout. So we had antibodies for a number of different proteins. I'll just show you one example over here. We had an antibody on the literature for an HIV capsid protein. We introduced the conserved mutations and we found antigen dependence. We then took that destabilized anti-HIV domain and fused it in tandem with our anti-GFP destabilized domain and fused the flip. And we asked, is flip activity stimulated only when both antigens are present? And indeed that worked. That's this column over here. Again, these are in vitro readouts of the cyclase. If both antigens are present, we have a great deal of induction. If none of the antigens are present, we have almost no activity. If one is present, we have a little bit of activity. So this then opens up the possibility again to gain access to a more specific subset of cells by using a combination of epitopes to turn on a dual nanobody fusion protein. So this is the last application I'll show you then. This is now to use these single nanobody fusions that are dependent on the presence of epitope and to use them as detectors. Now this is useful in a number of applications. If you just want to know if your antigen is present in a cell, let's say you're looking at a system where you're looking at an endogenous protein, one of these introduced intracellularly will give you the ability to see the turn on of your protein. This works much better than just putting a fusion protein in, because if you put a fusion protein in, it was not destabilized. So let's say you have a nanobody to antigen X, fused to GFE or GFE, that nanobody is stable in the absence of epitope, so your cell will have sort of a blue haze as a background. Here, if you put in a destabilized nanobody, there's no background. The nanobody goes away unless the epitope is present. So this is a very sensitive detector system. We went to test this on a virally infected set of cells. We went from HIV, worked with Jonathan Lee and his postdoc, Azad and Hamad. And what we wanted to know is whether HIV capsid protein, when induced, would enable cells to turn red if we put in our fusion protein, a destabilized fusion protein, to detect that. So we took a set of cells that were the parental lines are uninfected, so there should be no HIV epitope, and therefore no red on the fusion protein. That parental cell line is infected with HIV, it creates a derivative line. HIV in this scenario is latent, so you probably know that HIV, once it infects cells, can go quiet, not express any of its genes. But for reasons that are unknown, a person is chronically infected, they will reactivate the genome, and that's the point of study. People studying HIV biology would like to know what activates. And this gives them a way, if they can study this with our fusion protein, this gives them a way to screen for activation in a live cell population. They don't have to permeabilize the cells or do any of the other things we have to do normally to see an episode turn on, such as an incellular episode with the HIV capsid protein. So this cell line has a quiescent genome, but that genome can be activated by a chemical called DNA. So we took the parental cell line, the non-reactivated cells, and the reactivated cells, we introduced our destabilized anti-capsid nanobodies, as in this case with RFC. This is just a transfection control GFP, doesn't have anything to do with the nanobody. We then introduced these constructs and in fact to ask, would we get some red cells if we reactivated the HIV genome? You can see from the FACS plot, this is the area where the red protein was seen among the GFP transfected cells. The parental cells or the non-reactivated cells did not have any red cells. That's quantified over here. This is the reactivated HIV infected cells. This is the parental line. This is the non-reactivated infected cells, and again, the parental cells. So this is a very sensitive way to test reactivation of HIV. It can be used in high throughput screens. It's similar to be used to detect viral antigen and other infection scenarios. It's also can be used again to look at the induction of an endogenous protein, if that's your interest. And this is the last experiment then. We want to know if we could induce Cas9. I'm sure most of you know about CRISPR. One can enter genome editing specifically in the cell that expresses the epitope. We again use our HIV stabilized anti-HIV antibody in a double fusion scenario with Cas9, the enzyme. We tested this in a tissue culture system where LatV would be turned on. The guide RNA was then directing the Cas9 to excise the transcriptional stop. So Cas9 activity is indicated by LatV activity. We looked at a wild-type normal allele of Cas9 in this assay, and it worked quite well. So this is now LatV readout. So this is a normal, non-modified Cas9 in the presence of guide RNA. We set that activity to 100%. In the absence of guide RNA, there's no activity. And this is our destabilized fusion protein over here in the presence of HIV capsid. You can see we got quite a bit of activation, about 70% of what we see in the normal wild-type Cas9 allele, and it's dependent on epitope. If we read out HIV, we get very little activity. So now one can then use these fusions to direct the genome editing. I think this could even be used in a scenario where one... There are transgenics available, which shows at least that we can introduce exogenous genes, but as long as one can use viral delivery systems, one can then think about developing antibodies of these activities, for example, as part of GABAergic neurons in the cortex or whatever one is interested in. And I'll just end by thanking all the collaborators. I think I mentioned this as I went along. I would like to just point out one other thing, and that is I know that sometimes people are intimidated by a lot of molecular biology. You know, scientists are extremely sophisticated people. You do not need to be intimidated by any of this. And in fact, if you like, you can just buy these AEDs and inject them. You don't need to build any of the construct or really work with anything that might seem complicated. And you can buy them from Luke Vandenberg, who has the AEDs produced at the National Antivirus Corps and Nonprofit Corps. And please contact me if you're also interested. So I'll stop there and let's take questions.
We have 5 minutes for questions. I was wondering if you had tested your system on that.
toxic protein. Membrane proteins, I think, for the center, where's the epitopes, and how does the nanobody interact with the epitopes that I do before membrane protein, follow the knots? So my guess is it's not going to work on membrane proteins. Sorry, if you have one of those, that's one of those strategies.
I'll ask, you hear me? I'll ask two questions.